All right, Romans chapter 8, and it begins with the word therefore, so we have to put it in its context. One of the things that you hopefully learn as we go through the Bible is you'll be learning how to read the Bible for yourself. Hopefully you'll just kind of by observation and just practice of being in Bible study that you'll be able to learn on your own how to read the Bible. So you're paying attention to these words. Whenever you're reading your Bible, you always want to try to, and you're trying to understand a passage, you always want to put it in its context. The most important rule when you're studying the Bible is the context, okay? And if you just remember that, you will save yourself almost every single problem. You won't be able to answer every single question because the context in some places doesn't give you every single answer. But usually in that case, you're not going to be able to answer it even if you had a PhD. You could speculate, you know, and sound intelligent while you're speculating, but it would still be speculation. The context is the key. So if you're with your children and they read a Bible passage and they come to you and they say, I don't know what this means, and you're looking at it going, I have no idea what this means, smile really big and say, well, let's look at the verses right before. Let's look at the verses right after and just kind of go back, you know, a paragraph or two and start reading and then read through the passage and read couple paragraphs after, and it'll become really clear what the passage means. And most every false teaching, almost every single false teaching that you'll get on either a particular passage or just in its in a grander scale, it's always Bible verses taken out of context, like almost 100% of the time. So if you just remember that, so here we are, we're starting, we're going through the Bible chapter by chapter, but we look down, we're good Bible students, we look down. The first word that's not in italics, remember that the words in italics in your English translation are added by the translators to help kind of make sense. Maybe the wording in the original language doesn't translate cleanly into sort of our way of communicating. And so they'll supply some words to kind of let you know, like, well, this is what they're saying. This word maybe isn't actually there, but this is what we think it means. And so you'll know they're adding, they'll put it in italics. But the word-for-word translations, if it's not in italics, man, that's there in the Greek. That English word's representing a Greek word. So mine says, there is, therefore, and the there is in the New King James is in italics. So the first word in verse 1 is, therefore. So you have to say, we interrupted Paul right in the middle of a good point. You imagine if your wife sat you down and said, I need to talk to you about something. And she said, first of all, blah, blah, blah. And second of all, blah, blah. Therefore, and you say, wait, stop right there. I got to go watch the game. I mean, the whole point is the therefore, right? You're building up to something, and now you're going to say, this is what I'm saying. So, therefore, there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. So, let's just look back a few verses earlier, and we'll see that at the end of chapter 7, he's talking about the struggle within, the things that I don't want to do, that's what I end up doing, he says in verse 20. Sin is dwelling in me, and I see this happening. Verse 22, I delight in the law of God according to the inward man, but I see a different law, another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. Therefore, there's no condemnation. Therefore, now, no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. So he's, in the immediate context, he's summarizing a thought and completing it. There's a struggle, and the answer to that struggle is there's no condemnation. This isn't an issue of condemnation. And this also, you could say, is a therefore that fits. We've been studying through Romans from chapter 1 till now. This is a good therefore, right? If you take his argument, you know, the wrath of God revealed from heaven against all unrighteousness and ungodliness of men, and you know, even if you're self-righteous, you know, you're judging another, you practice the same things, you're condemned, and the Jewish person's condemned, and we're all under sin, all have fallen short of the glory of God and under the penalty of sin, but God set Jesus as that propitiation. Jesus is the way that we're saved, and you believe, and you're justified by faith, and that battle against sin, and therefore there's no condemnation. I mean, it fits. It's just a good conclusion statement for the whole book of Romans up to this point. And now he's going to continue on with this idea that he began in chapter 6 with how do we gain a victory? See, Christianity is not an excuse to sin. It's not a license to sin. Christianity is actually the provision of God to bring about the deliverance from sin, the penalty of sin, which God's done in the death of Jesus, but also the power of sin in the life of a human being. All of us know what it is to have a problem with sin. Every single human being knows that. And we all know what it feels like, the futility of that problem with sin that we have, the sense of dread of, well, I don't know that I'll ever get a victory over this. And Jesus' death on the cross is the answer. We are united with Jesus in his death. We experience deliverance over that master through death. And that's chapter 6 and chapter 7. And now he's going to continue and sort of finish that thought out. He kind of comes to the mighty conclusion of that. And he says in verse 1, those who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. Now, he had talked about in chapter 7 at the end, there's a law in my body. I see this law warring in my members. I'm a subject of sin. I delight in the law of God, but there's a different law in me. And now he says, well, how am I going to get rid of it? How do I deal with all this? Well, there's no condemnation because of what Jesus has done. And that death of Jesus on the cross has now provided a way for me to have a new law, which he calls the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Do you know that law? And that's a good law, isn't it? It's not the law of Moses. It's not the law of sin warring in my members. It's the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, the power of the life of God in me. This Holy Spirit produces the life of Christ in me, and it sets me free from the law of sin and death. Now, here's how. Verse 3, for what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh. This is something you find out as a parent, for sure. You can make rules for your kids, and it's very disappointing, because can they ever live up to any rule that you make up for them? They can't. And one of the things that quickly you become aware of as a parent is you start disciplining your kids for things that you do. That's hard. Why do you keep doing this? And then you're thinking, why do I keep doing this? And this kid's actually godlier than me, and I'm disciplining him. You know, you have my own sin nature. All I could transmit to you is what I got from my father, who got it all the way back to Adam, and now I have the sin nature, and now you have the same sin nature. And the law has a weakness, not because there's something wrong with the law, but Paul says the law could not do it because how was it weak? It was weak through the flesh. The law is fine, but what's the problem? The flesh. Flesh is never going to be subject to the law of God, he's going to say. The law could not do this. It was weak through the flesh, so God, sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. So that's the one side of it. What the law could not do it because our flesh was weak. So what God did is he sent his son in the likeness of sinful flesh and he condemned sin in the flesh. The victory over sin came in the body of Jesus when Jesus lived a sinless life and laid it down in sacrifice. Sin is condemned in the flesh. The victory over the sin came in flesh. Now, that's a radical thing to say because I think the victory over sin did not come in my flesh. My flesh is sin. If you say, hey, Rich, are you in the flesh today? I'd say, oh, man, please, God, help me not to be in the flesh today. But God condemned sin in the flesh. But it was Jesus. Jesus' sinless flesh. Jesus won the victory. God sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and on account of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. That's the one side. Now the other side, verse 4, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us. Now that's another radical statement. This whole chapter, I mean, it's a, we're trying to go through the Bible, so please forgive me. But we could literally spend 10 years in the book of Romans. Every phrase here is amazing. The righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us. Think of that, the righteous requirement of the law. Now, Paul's not inventing something. This is not Paul the theologian pioneering some new theological concept. This is biblical. You can go back to the Old Testament, the promise of the new covenant. The promise of the new covenant comes with the statement that God is now going to write his law where? In our hearts. Not on the outside. You can go through things in behavior and have your heart not be right. We've all done that. We've all, you know, obeyed in some sense, but on the inside, man, our heart, we were just bitter or mad or whatever the issue was. It was on the inside. Now, the law, though, in the new covenant is on the inside. Not only that, Jesus said, unless your righteousness surpasses the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you won't enter the kingdom of heaven. And the scribes and Pharisees had worked out an external righteousness and sort of an exacting, probably fairly hypocritical, but in some senses very exacting kind of an obedience to parts of the law. I wouldn't say all of the law, like justice or love or mercy. They omitted that, Jesus said. But on the dietary laws and a bunch of aspects of the law, they were very exacting. Jesus said, your righteousness has to surpass theirs, or you're not going to heaven. Now, there's two ways he's talking about that. One is, I mean, two ways that that's fulfilled. One is in his death. We get imputed righteousness. We receive righteousness by believing in Jesus. The second way is what Paul's talking about here. In the death of Jesus, God condemns sin in the flesh, that now, because of what Jesus did, the righteous requirement of the law, by justification by faith, but also by the power of the Spirit. You see, now as a Christian, our righteousness has to exceed the righteousness that would be in the law. Because the law says don't murder, but as a Christian, you're supposed to be kind to everybody. The law says you're supposed to love your neighbor as yourself. But Jesus said you need to love your neighbor more than you love yourself. The righteous requirement that is given to us by Jesus surpasses the law. It's deeper, it's richer, it's fuller. So the righteous requirement of the law will be fulfilled in us because of what Jesus has done. And he says, those of us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now this is a repetition of the same phrase at the end of verse 1. Some versions, some of the Greek manuscripts don't have this phrase in verse 1. It's debatable about whether it was there. You can read the commentaries and the textual critics have different opinions about whether or not they think, well, is it there? Should it be there? Should it not be there? And this is a good place to talk about how we didn't have the Bible fall down from heaven perfectly, okay? We don't have the original autographs. We don't have Paul's writing. We don't have the, you know, firsthand copy of what Paul wrote. But we have hundreds and hundreds of fragments from within just a few decades of when this is written, and we have hundreds and hundreds of fuller copies within 100 years of when this is written, or 200 years. We have the early church fathers quoting the majority of the New Testament, you know, writing within 150 years, 200 years of when the New Testament was written. So when they're trying to understand, is this in the text, and you'll hear people say, well, men have messed around with it, or they've changed it, or whatever. Here's an example where we're not sure. Is that phrase there because we have some manuscripts that are old that don't have it? We have others that are pretty old and they do have it. Well, here's a perfect example. Do you think this is a corruption of the text? Because the phrase we're concerned about is, they don't walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Well, in the context, that exact phrase occurs like two verses later. So whether it's in there or not, we have a text that is compiled together by the scholars that study this stuff and put it all together and try to compare the differences. Is this a major difference that's going to change the meaning of the passage? What's the answer? No. In fact, the phrase we're talking about is in the passage, in another place where it's in every manuscript. We're not talking about four or five manuscripts. I think some of the ancient, like Homer, one of the writings of Homer, there's like six copies. And they're within about 500 years of when he wrote it. We have hundreds of copies within decades, or, you know, 100 years of when the New Testament is written. And when we're talking about some of these variations, we're talking about some manuscripts are from Africa, some are from found in near Israel, some are found in Europe. We're talking about, like, different parts of the world, and within, you know, and the variations are very minor. So while we don't have the original inerrant manuscripts, we do believe the Bible is inerrant. And we do have some of these places where some manuscripts from one area are missing a certain phrase, but never is there any place where you would come to one of these arguments or whatever you'd call it, you know, a question about a phrase where it changes the meaning of the passage. The deity of Christ, salvation through Jesus Christ, death on the cross, everything that the New Testament teaches, there isn't a problem with any of that. There's just certain phrases here or there that might be missing part of a phrase or a couple words. But if you think of just us in this room, if we try to tell the same story and tell it and keep it the same while we all traveled for the next 40 years, how close do you think we'd get 40 years from now that anything that we said would be even remotely like what we said tonight? I mean, it would never happen. You're talking about people that travel on foot and hundreds of miles away from each other have copies of Romans in different parts of the world that are almost identical. That's amazing. When all this stuff is hand copied and written on animal skins and weird papyrus things, and I mean, it's amazing. So some of your versions in verse 1 will be missing that phrase, but you don't have to feel bad because your version has it a couple verses later. Okay, just so you have a little textual criticism argument, which seems to me to be a big fat waste of time when we're in the coolest chapter, maybe in the whole Bible. So, but you need to know about that. So, here's the argument he's making: the law couldn't do it; God did. He condemned sin in the flesh, but the positive side, what God saved us to, is the righteous requirement of the law is now going to be fulfilled in us as we walk in the Spirit. Now that is amazing. That means that I'm raised in a broken home. My dad's an alcoholic. My parents got divorced when I was a teenager. I was super messed up. I got saved at 17 years old. My wife and I meet each other. Her family, they weren't believers. There's a lot of dysfunction in her family, a lot of dysfunction in my family. She just turned 21. I turned 20. We get married. What are the chances we're going to make it a week? Pretty slim. Unless God condemned sin in the flesh through the death of Jesus Christ, and that now the righteous requirement of the law can be fulfilled in us who do not walk in the flesh, but walk after the Spirit. You see, if we begin to walk in the Spirit, and I start to say no to my flesh, and I stop living a selfish life because now the Spirit of God is living inside of me, and he starts to fulfill the righteous requirement of the law. And the law can be summed up in two commandments. We don't have a problem with the law, right? Jesus said, what's the greatest commandment? Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. What's the second one? Love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus gave us one, a new one. He kind of changed the second one and said, love one another the way I loved you. The righteous requirement of the law, which could be summed up as love. So what are the chances that Gina and I are going to be able to love? Well, if we walk in the Spirit, pretty good. Pretty good chance. If we walk in the flesh, not so much, right? So when you're having marital problems, what do you think you want to do to fix them? The marriage is like a barometer, and it tells you how you're doing with the Spirit, right? Things aren't going good in the marriage, you might want to decide to start walking in the Spirit, stop walking in the flesh. Now, usually what happens in marriage, we think, I am walking in the Spirit, it's that idiot I'm married to. Right? It's always the spouse's problem. We need to take personal responsibility. Man, what an awesome thing. The righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. That's amazing to me. Verse 5, for those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. These are the people that we are around who don't know Jesus. When people are in the flesh, do they set their mind on the thing of the flesh? Oh, man. You hear it all day long when you're at work. They'll tell you, oh, wait till this weekend. I mean, like, look, dude, get your mind on something else. No, man, this weekend, that's what I'm doing. They're in the flesh, their mind's on the thing of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit, what's their mind on? The things of the Spirit. So if we're walking in the Spirit, what do we put our mind on? Now, this is a discipline, isn't it? This is a Christian discipline. Does your mind naturally want to go to that? No, you have to say, well, no, wait. I'm dead with Christ. I'm risen to walk in a new life. I've got this victory, and now I'm going to put my mind on the things of the Spirit. To be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. When we're in the flesh, man, and we're trying to think about how we can make things work for us, there's no peace there. None whatsoever. And I make everything go so I can feel good. And there's just no peace living like that. The carnal mind is enmity against God, verse 7 says. It's against him. It's not subject to the law of God. And this is interesting. Nor indeed can it be. A mind in the flesh cannot even be subject to God. So verse 8, so then those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. If anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. Now if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Therefore, brethren, we're debtors. That has everything to do with obligation. We're obligated as Christians. We're liberated, but in our liberation comes an accountability, and that debtor. We're a debtor not to live to the flesh, but to live according, or not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you'll die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you'll live. So the Spirit of God now living inside of us, so Paul's the point he's making, we're saved from our sin and its penalty by the death of Jesus. We're saved to this new life. How does this new life work? Well, those that are in the flesh have their mind on the things of the flesh. Here's how it works. You're in the Spirit now. You put your mind on the things of the Spirit. And the Holy Spirit's now inside of you. You're now filled with the Spirit. He's made your heart his home. And while your body and your members is dead because of sin, but you've got this life of the Spirit inside of you, so we can now live by the Spirit, putting to death the deeds of the body. The Spirit will help you to get a victory over your flesh. If you need a victory over your flesh, then just seek the Lord. The flesh is just not ever going to change. It's always going to be there. It's always going to be your enemy. He says earlier, the carnal mind can't even be subject to the law of God. One of the things that I was, as a new Christian, thinking, it's because I didn't understand, I was really thinking that as I grew as a Christian, that my flesh would change, that it would get better. And what I've realized is my flesh is the same. It has never changed. And that's why you can see people who are pastors or someone who's gone along for many years, and then you'll hear about how they fell into sin. And it can be shocking because you think, wow, they've gone so far and they've done so much. And for so long, they were doing things the right way. And then what happened and how did they fall? Well, here's how it happened. Their flesh. That flesh never, like, well, that guy doesn't have a flesh anymore. Oh, he has a flesh. And if he feeds it, what will happen? It will grow. If he listens to it, what will it do? It will take over. All of us, it's the same. So the flesh is always going to be there. It never goes away. It never will be subject to the law of God. So what do we have to do? We walk in the Spirit instead, and by the power of the Spirit, we're killing that dude all the time and never stop. We put to death the deeds of the body by the Spirit, and so we live. Verse 14, this is how it will happen. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. He's concluding one thought, introducing the next thought. How does this happen? You're going to be led by the Spirit to put to death the deeds of the body. The Holy Spirit will bust you when you're proud. The Holy Spirit will bust you when you're impatient. The Holy Spirit will bust you when you're rude. He'll bust you when you're angry. He's going to bust you when you're greedy. He's going to bust you when you're cheating. He's going to be living inside of you saying, that ain't the way we do it around here. And you're going to think, that's the way we've always done it, as far as I'm concerned. And now you and he are going to have to, and you're going to have a conversation with him, and you're going to say, wait a minute, that's my flesh. Here's what the Scripture says. And then you're going to say, Lord, by the power of the Spirit, help me put this thing to death. And that's the Christian life. It's a battle. There's nothing in the Scriptures that would make you think that walking with Jesus is an easy thing to do. Now, it involves abiding, which it has an implication of just simply staying connected. But that act of staying connected, while it's very simple, it involves a huge battle, a battle with the flesh. And so we're led by the Spirit. And in this particular case, the context the leading of the Spirit is not sort of a leading out into missions or a leading into some kind of ministry. It's being led by the Spirit specifically to gain a victory over my flesh. Aren't you glad someone lives inside of you that's helping you win the victory against your flesh? God looks at us and he thinks, I so want you to not be in the flesh, I'm going to come live inside of you, because that's the only way it's going to happen. And what do we say to that? We say, you're right, that's the only way it's going to happen. If you kill the old me, separate me and give me a new life, and then come live inside of me and help me, then maybe we have some kind of a chance of the Lord giving us a victory. Otherwise, we won't be able to do it. So led by the Spirit, but that leads him to this concept of being the Son of God. And he's going to take this idea and really begin to develop it. And this is sort of one of the fruits that blossoms or flowers that blossoms out of the justification by faith. He had said in chapter 5, therefore we have peace with God. We're justified by faith. This wonderful relationship with God, harmony with God, communion with God, because we've trusted in what Jesus did. And this is one of those unfolding blossoms. We're now the sons of God. We're adopted into God's family. We bear the marks of our Heavenly Father. You know, the genetic code, if you will, the Spirit's inside of us. We've got the love of God. God is love. Now the love of God's inside of us. God's our Father. So we're led by the Spirit. Now we're the sons of God. Verse 15, and we connected these verses directly to the passage we were in on Wednesday night. You didn't receive a spirit of bondage again to fear. Our relationship with God is not one of slavery and, you know, fear, domination. Instead, he said, you received the spirit of adoption by which we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we're the children of God. So the Spirit helps me to put to death the deeds of the body. The Spirit leads me, and the Spirit is telling me how precious I am to God. What a blessing to have the Holy Spirit living inside of you. The Spirit himself bears witness with what? My mind? What does it say? Read the verse again. The Spirit bears witness with our spirit. The Spirit inside, my spirit, the real me, not my flesh or my soul, but my spirit, the Spirit of God is in there with my spirit, and he's telling my spirit, you belong to God. God's adopted you. He saw you in this giant orphanage called Planet Earth, and he said, I want that little guy. He looks like he needs a home. I'll take him. I want him. You know, I think David wrote it in the Psalms, if my mother and father forsake me, the Lord will take me up. Adopted, man, the Spirit of God inside me saying, you belong to me now. It's communion with my spirit. Now, we normally think about taking in information like in our ears or in our eyes or, what are you cooking? You know, we're catching some information, right? We have these senses. We touch something and say, oh, man, you're hot. I think you have a fever. We touch. We get information. We could taste something and say, oh, man, you need some cooking lessons. You know, what was that? You just put sugar in that. Oh, whew. You know, we get information these different ways. How does the information go from the Spirit of God to my spirit? Does it go through the neurons? I mean, how does that information get in there? Think about that. Direct connection. The plug from heaven plugs into my spirit. And you belong to God. How does that, what language is that? Like, how does that information come? When you're a child of God, you have it inside of you, don't you? You say, man, I know God belonged to God. We've come to know and we believe the love that God has for us, the spirit of adoption inside of us. What a blessing. Then he goes on. He says, now if we're children, verse 17, if we're children, then what comes with being a child? We're heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. So everything that belongs to Jesus said this. Paul's not making this up again. This is something that Jesus himself said and emphasized. Everything that's mine is yours, he told his disciples. Everything that's the Father's is mine, and everything that's mine is yours. And you think, man, I really got adopted into a good family. This is a pretty cool system here. I am now an heir of God and a joint heir with Jesus. But not only that, also the suffering. If indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. For the Christian, we have a different view of suffering than the world. in the world, because they're in the flesh, they're walking in the flesh, there's the idea, and Christians fall into this when they're walking in the flesh. The flesh says, please me, please me, please me. This has to go my way. I want it this way. This is what I have. This is my thing. Meet my needs. That's the flesh. And then suffering is an enemy of that. So all suffering must be excluded. That's why the false teaching, you know, of prosperity and all of that, it appeals to the flesh. So, okay, let's have a doctrine, no suffering. You know, just have enough faith and you can make it so you'll never suffer. Well, the flesh goes, that's a good doctrine. I want some of that. And so that false doctrine is super impacting the whole world. It's all over the place. Paul's talking about something different. We're no longer in the flesh. We're now thinking about please Jesus. Pleasing Jesus involves suffering because we're no longer living self-centered lives. We're now being led by the Spirit, and the Spirit's saying, lay down your life. Give up your rights. Give up your money. Give up your time. Give up your energy. Sacrifice. And so the follower of Jesus now has the Spirit of God inside of him or her, and now he or she begins to live in this way, and suffering becomes part of it. But we know that with Jesus, there was suffering, and his suffering led to his glory. He's crucified, but he's raised from the dead. So we're not afraid of suffering because we know suffering always leads to what? Glory. God's glory. That glorious wonder, what God's going to do. We don't know how it's going to turn out, but man, we know he's got it handled. He handled it for Jesus. We're in Jesus. We're joint heirs with him. And if necessary, we also suffer with him. Not suffering for its own sake, but suffering for Jesus' sake. And we'll be glorified with him. Then he says this, verse 18, and this is a consideration. Now we're going to something mental. He said, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that will be revealed in us. Have you made the same mental calculation? Paul says, I thought about this, and I've come to a conclusion. I've made a mental calculation, and I've decided this. Whatever happens to me right now is nothing compared to what is going to happen to me later. And whatever I give up now, and whatever I miss out on now, whatever somebody says, Paul, you were so smart, you could have done this. Paul, you had this opportunity, you could have done that. Paul, your dad was doing this, and you could have gone this direction. He said, I'm certain that the sufferings right now are nothing compared to the glory that's going to be revealed later. Have you made the same calculation? It'll change your life if you do. He then talks about this suffering now and glory that's going to be revealed, and he uses the creation as his focal point. Look at verse 19. The earnest expectation of the creation. When he says that, what's he talking about? What creation is he talking about? He's talking about the earth, everything on it. Plants, trees, animals, whatever God created, the universe. The creation is waiting, he says, eagerly waiting for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility. Now there's, you can underline that word futility. That's where we're living, in futility. The creation has been subjected to futility. Why? Because of sin. The sons of men have sinned, and they brought the corruption of sin into the world, and the whole creation is now subjected to futility. And Paul's giving the analogy, personifying the creation, saying the creation is eagerly waiting for and looking for the revealing of the sons of God. Because what's going to happen to the creation when the sons of God are revealed? It's going to be glorious. It's going to be changed. It wasn't subjected willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. There was a hope because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. This, again, Paul's not making this up. You can go back into Isaiah. There's a number of prophecies in Isaiah and scattered throughout the Old Testament prophets talking about the millennial kingdom, the reign of the Messiah upon the earth, when he's going to make the lion and the lamb lay down together, and the child can play by the poisonous snake's hole and be able to put his hand in there. The carnivores are going to eat straw. You know, the lion will eat straw like an ox. And you think, oh, you mean I'll be able to have a pet lion and I won't have to be afraid? Yeah, man. You're like, that's going to be weird. We won't have droughts and it won't be 100 degrees. No, man, Hawaii, everywhere, the whole planet, dude. You know, you're in one certain climate and your body thinks, no, no, I was made for this climate. And then you're in other climates and you're thinking, my body was not made for this climate. Crazy humidity, super cold temperatures, biting wind. And Brandon's looking, I said humidity. Brandon's like, humidity, man, that's home. No, you were not made for that. No, he's like, I wasn't. I came to California. You know, but you walk in this, there's some climate, you know, and you feel it and you're like, man, this is it. I'm here. I was made for this. I can live like this. The creation has been subjected to futility, and the creation, Paul says, is groaning, waiting for the revelation of the glorious liberty of the sons of God, and the earth is going to be changed. Now, we know in the book of Revelation tells us that after that millennial kingdom, the earth is going to be destroyed. The earth is not eternal, and the heavens aren't eternal. They're going to be destroyed with a tremendous heat, Peter says. It's going to be rolled up like a scroll and disappear. Revelation says there won't be any place that when the great white throne is set up and him who sits on the throne, it says, from whose face heaven and earth flee and no place is found for them. It's just gone. So the world as we know it, the natural universe as we know it, it's not forever, but there is a redemption of it, and it will take place in that thousand-year reign of Jesus that the book of Revelation points to and several other places. So the creation's groaning and waiting for the redemption. Verse 22, we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pangs together until now. Not only that, but we, so not just the creation, but we, and you guys know this feeling, we also have the first fruits of the Spirit. We ourselves groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. I was just talking with someone this morning who is going to have a surgery on some kind of artery problem it's gotten bigger and it's gotten worse and you know, but she's older. I asked them their age today. I think she said she's 80 years old, something like that. She has to get this surgery. And so she's like, can you pray? And I prayed for her and I got done praying. And then she goes, but I'm ready to go be with Jesus. You know, she's in that body and she's saying, man, I'm groaning. You know, like I'm ready. I'm ready. Like if the creation's groaning, I'm groaning. Like let's go for it, Lord. Let's make this happen. I'm ready. We're waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For we were saved with this hope. We're saved with the hope of the resurrection. But verse 24 says, but hope that's seen is not hope. That's why you're not allowed to open your Christmas presents. You know, when you're a kid and they wrap them up and you think, man, I hope I got what I want. And you go over there and open it up 3 days before you get busted. Hope that's seen is not hope. Right? Why does one still hope for what he sees? Well, that would no longer be hope. It would be called, oh, I didn't get what I wanted. Or, oh, look, they gave me what I wanted. I mean, you don't know. Hope means something hasn't happened yet. You're hoping for it. We're hoping. But verse 25, if we hope for what we don't see, so here's what we do. We eagerly wait for it with perseverance. That's what we're doing. We're eagerly waiting for what? The redemption of our bodies, the redemption of this world, God's victory over sin, and we're waiting for it with perseverance. So if someone ever asked you what you were doing, you could memorize this verse and you could tell them, what are you doing? Man, I'm eagerly waiting for the redemption of my body. What are you doing? I'm sitting in line at the DMV. I thought that's what you were doing. I'm here too, but I'm not just waiting for that number to change to my number. I am eagerly waiting for my redemption with perseverance. And the Spirit, again, so we're back to the Spirit. The Spirit also helps. Now, we started a section in chapter 6 that is what we're saved to, and we've had an emphasis on our being united with Jesus in his death, and now Jesus in his resurrection, but in chapter 8, the focus is really on the Spirit, the work of the Spirit in the life of the believer. The Spirit is helping me put to death the deeds of the body. I'm now walking in the Spirit, not walking in the flesh. I'm being led by the Spirit. The Spirit is moving in me that I belong to God, and I'm adopted, and I've got this Spirit of adoption, communicating with my spirit, not with my mind, but directly with my spirit, and also helping in my weaknesses. I'm trying to wait with perseverance, and I'm not doing a good job, so who's helping me? God himself. Like, man, I need some help. Who can help me? God says, I'll help you. I live inside of you. I'm going to help you wait with perseverance and give you this hope and help you live with that hope and help you have the right focus. The Spirit helps in our weaknesses. And then he adds this. He's going to talk about one of the other ways the Spirit helps. He says, we don't know what we should pray for as we ought. Now, I've found that to be true in my own life. So many times I was praying for something, and as time went on and the Lord wouldn't answer my prayer, and then my prayer changed. I was praying for something, and it wasn't really God's will. And, you know, you don't really know how you ought to pray, so who's going to help you do that? The Spirit. He's going to say, no, I'm not answering that one. You need to change the way you're praying. This is all, you know, your focus is messed up. You don't see the big picture. You got to see this as what's happening. And specifically, he bypasses our brain. Look at what it says in verse 26. The Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. Now, we know from other passages who's interceding for us day and night. Jesus, right? Very clear. But Paul's telling us who else is interceding for us. The Holy Spirit. So he's inside of you. He's the very Spirit of God. He's not just some mystical force or some electrical impulse or something. He's a person. He's the third person of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. He's God. He's inside of us. But his ministry for us, leading us, helping us, strengthening us, giving us hope, perseverance, all these different things. But one of the other things he does for us, Paul adds, when we don't know what to pray, he's praying for us. And it says he's praying with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now, some people take this and they'll say this is sort of a reference to speaking in tongues. That's the Spirit, you know, making utterance, you know, and with these groanings that can't be really spoken. I don't think that's what he's talking about here. I think he's talking about the Spirit's communion with the Father. Because look at the next verse. Look at verse 27. He who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is. Who's the one who searches the hearts? We just say, well, that's the Father. Who's interceding for me? The Spirit. The Spirit who searches the hearts knows what the Father who's searching the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is. The perfect communion that is in the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, well, that perfect communion's in me, and that perfect communion that they have is part of that intercessory work on my behalf. The Spirit's helping me, and the Father who knows the mind of the Spirit, and the Spirit's doesn't have to communicate with utterance. It's this perfect communication. He who searches the hearts knows the mind of the Spirit because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. So when the Holy Spirit's interceding for us or Jesus' intercession for us, it's perfect. Now, if I might intercede for you, I love you, and so you say, I've got this situation coming up, and on Tuesday this is coming down, and you were talking this morning about tribulation and distress and peril, and man, I got all of that on Tuesday. Will you pray for me? You know how I'm going to pray? I love you. You know what I'm going to pray? I'm going to pray, Lord, get him out of it. Lord, don't let anything bad happen to him. Lord, help him to have peace. Lord, rescue him. And the Holy Spirit's going, groanings that can't be uttered. He who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, and the Spirit makes intercession according to the will of God. And the Spirit might be saying, more stress, they're not broken. I don't know if I'm not going to pray that for you. If you ask me for prayer, I'm going to be nice to you. I'll say, Lord, just get him out of it. No, Lord, break him. Lord, as I'm praying for this person, I can sense a lot of pride still there. Crush him. Crush him on Tuesday, Lord. Grind him to dust. Right? That might be, that probably would be the best thing to pray for me on, you know, many times in my life. Because that's what God did, right? It was what I needed. You know, that's not really a nice way to pray for somebody. But the intercession's according to the will of God. The Holy Spirit, he's not messing around. He's not waiting for somebody else to pray. Jesus is interceding for us. The Holy Spirit's interceding for us. We have, again, the perfect picture of the heart and nature of God completely. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit. They're all one. They're all doing the same thing. They're together in this. Distinct and yet one. They all have their ministry, yet the same. I mean, it's amazing, this marvel who God is. So he makes this intercession, and then we have this wonderful verse, verse 28. We know that all things then work together for good to those who love God and to those who are the called according to his purpose. This is one of those verses. It's one of the first ones we always memorize. If you don't have this memorized, man, make it your homework for this week. Get this one down. Put it in your heart. All things work together for good. Now, the key to understanding it is, how do you define these terms? All things. Well, how do you define that? Well, that's everything. Even the bad things, even the stupid things, even the dumb things you do. Everything, it's really clear, all things. But the term that's the key one is the word good. All things work together according to what Rich wants. Is that always good? No, it's not. Most of the time, in fact, isn't good. And in the context, Paul's going to define for us what good means. We love God. We're called according to his purpose. That's part of what good is, right? God's going to work it out. It's going to be related to the love of God. It's going to be related to the purpose of God. But then look at verse 29. We know everything works together for good because, verse 29 says, because those whom God foreknew, he also predestined. This word predestined, you know, becomes a huge theological concept. Predestined to salvation, predestined to be lost, the whole five-point hyper-Calvinism thing. And in the context, we're predestined specifically. It has nothing to do with salvation. God knew ahead of time, and the people that he knew about ahead of time, he predestined specifically something in the verse. What does it say? He predestined to conform them to the image of his son, that Jesus might be the firstborn among many brothers, many brethren. So the predestination has everything to do with God making me just like Jesus. That is one of the most amazing things that anyone ever said, ever in all of human history, that I am going to be just like Jesus. Now, you would take predestination for that to happen. I mean, it would take Jesus dying on a cross, me dying with him, me having the life of the Spirit in me, interceding for me, leading me, and God working everything, going, I'm going to work everything together in this guy's life, and when I'm done, he's going to be just like Jesus. And all I can say to that is, bring it on, Lord, please. It's the sooner the better. Amen. My heart cries out and says, less of me, more of Jesus, right? You're predestined to be conformed to the image of God's Son. That's amazing. So the things that are happening to you, Jesus is so patient. So guess what's going to happen to you? You're going to get to learn that. Isn't that awesome? You're going to wait so many times. Jesus is kind to evil and unthankful people. So guess what's going to happen for you? There's going to be all kinds of evil and unthankful people in your life. And you'll get to learn how to love them. Jesus loves his enemies. So guess what you get to have? A bunch of enemies. That's neat, isn't it? We could just go on and on all night. So God works all things together for good. That's not a bandage that we put on a cancer. And if you put it in its context, that's the way you think when you're in a situation. You think, all right, Lord, how are you using this to make me like Jesus? But those that are in the flesh, how do they look at a trial or a situation? Like, get me out of this, man. Like, why is this happening to me? I'm awesome, and my life should be awesome. That's the flesh. The person that's in the Spirit, being led by the Spirit, will recognize God's trying to do something in my life. What's God trying to do in my life? And that will set you free. And then this amazing statement, this little section right here is just, to me, so profound. I think these sentences here are some of the greatest sentences ever written by a human being. He says in verse 30, moreover, whom he predestined, these he called. Whom he called, these he also justified. Whom he justified, these he also glorified. What shall we say to these things? That's amazing. This progression, predestined. Well, he had already said earlier, there's a step before predestined. Look at verse 29 again. Those whom he foreknew, he also predestined. So this progression starts a little earlier. Foreknowledge, predestination, calling, justified, glorified. Look at that list. That's amazing. This is what God's done for us in Jesus. This is the gospel. The gospel started off with foreknowledge and it ends in glory. What are we going to say this? And then he gives us some rhetorical questions. What are the answers to these questions? Verse 31, what do we say to these things? What's the answer to that? What would you say to this? You say, man, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. That's just whatever language I got. Hebrew, hallelujah. English, praise the Lord. Some other language, blah, blah, blah. Whatever, you know. God's awesome. What are you going to say to that? What's the answer to the next question? If God's for us, who could be against us? Now, careful before you answer that one. If God's for me, who could be against me? My mother-in-law? My kids? Didn't Jesus say, man's enemies will be those in his own house? Who's going to be against you? The government could be against you? This is an interesting one. It's a rhetorical question. Rhetorical questions are designed to make us think. So, if God's for me, who could be against me? Well, man. Who could David say? King Saul could be against me for years and chase me around unethically, immorally, ungodly, unbiblically, maintaining power because he's in the flesh and make me live in a cave and run around and have all this bad stuff happen to me. So who can be against me? Well, what's the answer? If God's for me, who could be against me? Did God work everything together for good for David when he was running around in the caves? Did that have a huge impact on David? Where did David get his mighty men? Those people that were loyal to him through the rest of his life, who were those people? And when did they come to him? So God works it out for good. If God's for me, who could be against me? So you got to be careful because a lot of people are going to be against you. You just got to remember God's still for you and God's working it out for good. And remember what good is, making you more like Jesus. So it's not bad. He asks another question in verse 32. He who did not spare his own son for us, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? What's the answer to that question? If God gave his son for us, isn't God going to give us everything? And what's the answer? You bet. He sure is. He's going to do it. Yes, he is. Verse 33. What's the answer to this question? Who will bring a charge against God's elect? Your mother-in-law? Your son? Your daughter? Have you ever had somebody bring a charge against you as one of God's elect? I remember when I was newly saved, my mom, God bless her, the Lord used her before she became a Christian because, man, she held me accountable. I told her I got saved and, shared the gospel with her, and she wasn't that interested in the gospel at that point. And I remember she really used it. She manipulated me. She knew I was a Christian, like, you're a Christian. Your room should change. Your room should look different. Like, okay, I'll clean my room now. You need to work more around the house. All right, I'll work more around that. I mean, she worked me. Who can bring a charge against God's elect? Your mom, apparently. The devil, it says, who accuses them before God day and night. The devil brings a charge against God's elect. All kinds of people bring charges against God's elect. But here's the thing. This is a question we need to think about it. Lots of people, lots of entities will bring charges against God's elect. But there's only one person's opinion that matters, right? Right? God's. And that's what Paul says. That's his answer. He says in verse 33, it's God who justifies. So if you come to me and you go, man, I don't think you're much. You did this and that. And then God whispers in my ear, I love you and I like what you're doing. I can just smile and go, I'm sorry. I'm sorry you feel that way. I'm sorry I hurt your feelings. You forgive me, please? Right? If God justifies you, that every other voice doesn't mean anything, right? God's justified. Then verse 34, what's the answer to that question? Who is the one who condemns? Jesus said, the Father has given all judgment to the Son. So when we're judged, we're going to be judged by Jesus. So if someone's lost, it'll be the one who died on the cross for their sins and paid the penalty for sin who will say, I came and I died and I paid it all and I had my hand out to you. I stretched out my hands to you and you rejected it your whole life. And so you're lost. Christ is the one who condemns. That's what Paul says. Verse 34, but he puts it differently, words it differently. Who is the one who condemns? Christ who died. So are you worried? Remember it started off, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So who's going to condemn you? Well, the one who died for me. I'm not so much worried then about condemnation because I'm in Christ. He died for me to save me from condemnation. If that's the one who's going to condemn me, I think I'm okay, right? That's the point he's making. He's at the right hand of God. He makes intercession for us. So who's the one that's going to condemn you? The one who died for me, who loves me, who stands at the right hand of God, having my back. I'm not really worried about condemnation anymore. I'm saved by Jesus. Then he asks another question. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? And this is the wonderful answer. Tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? Can any of these things, or do any of those things signify that we're separated from God? He says there's even a verse in the Old Testament. For your sake we're killed all day long. We're counted as sheep for the slaughter. If everything goes wrong and we're just slaughtered like sheep, does that mean God doesn't love us? Now, Islam right now, there's this battle, like this raging, this rise of apocalyptic Islam and the violence and the evil of the Islamic State and what they're doing and the millions of people who are displaced by them and the thousands that have suffered death because of them and the evil that they are. It's one of the worst evils that we've seen on the planet. I mean, it's evil. It's just pure evil. And this idea of you're going to dominate and that your domination proves that God's with you, and the fact that you're able to brutalize people proves that God's with you, and the fact that you're winning, it's a religion of power. It's Baal worship. It's the Baal worship of the Old Testament, the religion of power, dominating, subjecting women, the systematic raping of women, the brutally murdering people. It's just, it's not new. It's happened many times under different names, but this is happening right now on the planet, and there's a message in there of, like, this is how you know that you're right. And so they look at people who are being slaughtered like lambs and say, that's a sign that you're not right. And here's what the Bible says. Tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, or sword. It's written, we're killed all day long. We're counted like sheep or the slaughter. Look at verse 37. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. You know who wins? If you lay down your life, you'll take it up again. Jesus said, if unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it brings forth much fruit. And Jesus died on the cross and was buried. And when he rose from the dead, the victory was won. Satan was defeated. The message of Satan is crush and rule and destroy and manipulate and take. And the message of the cross is surrender. Surrender to the will of God. This doesn't mean that we don't fight against the Islamic State. It doesn't mean that you don't have the right of self-defense and all that. It's not that. Paul's talking about us as we're living our lives and we're going through certain things. Don't think that when you're going through something and you're taking a beating that you're losing, because you're not. In all of these things, you're more than conquerors through him who loved us. Jesus has already won the victory, and because we're in him, we're going to win the victory in spite of tribulation, because God's working it all together for good. God's going to win. God's done it. God's done this for us. The Spirit's done it. Jesus has done this. So, Paul then says, verse 38, remember he said earlier, I consider this glory to be revealed. Now he says this in verse 38, I'm persuaded that neither death nor life, or angels, or principalities, or powers, those would be spiritual forces. No angels, principalities, or powers, not any angel, not the devil himself, not any archangel that's under the obedience of God, nothing angelic, spiritual, not death or life, not things present or things to come. It's interesting he doesn't talk about anything from the past. Why? Because it's already gone. It can't hurt you. You don't have to worry about that one. It's already passed. Whatever's present right now and whatever thing would ever come, nor height nor depth. If you went up as high as you could go, you won't find anything. If you went down, you won't find anything. And then he just goes broad. Or any other created thing, nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. This message of Christianity, of a total victory, no matter what the circumstances look like, has carried the church for 2,000 years. There's persecution all around the world. There have been terrible times of persecution in the church's history. Everywhere the church is, though, the gates of hell can't prevail against it. In another month, I'm going to be going to teach at a pastors and leaders conference in Thailand, and I'm going to go to another country before I go to Thailand, and I'm going to get to spend several days with the underground church. And I'm super excited about it. And you think there's literally millions and millions of believers who live in places where it's against the law for them to meet publicly. They can't print Bibles there. They can't openly worship. And if there are quote unquote churches, they're controlled by the government and the doctrine's changed and all this stuff. But you know what? You kill Christians, the church explodes. There's an old saying, 2,000-year-old saying. I mean, it goes way back. The blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. It's just a reality. So Paul's looking at this in his day. He's already been persecuted terribly. He's had all these different things happen to him. He's about to go to Jerusalem with the offering. That's why he's writing this letter. Remember, we've covered that in the book of Acts. He's going to go and be beaten and then rescued and then go off to prison, shipwrecked, bit by a snake. All this stuff's yet to happen to him. He's had all these other things already happen to him. And he said, listen, don't think for a moment that all these things happening to you mean you're separated from God's love. God's working everything around for good. He's going to make you just like Jesus, and we win, you guys. We win. We're more than conquerors. And one of the great things about Greek is some of our words in English are borrowed from Greek, like the word super. They don't have the S sound on it, but the Greek prefix "uper," it's a U and a P sound and an E-R sound. You put that on front and it makes something super. So Paul takes the word for conqueror, which is the English word Nike. Straight out of Greek. The Greek word for conqueror is Nike. So guess what Phil Knight called his shoe company? He called it Conqueror and made a little conquering swoosh on it. Nike. More than conquerors is super Nike. It means whatever, if it's conquering, man, in Jesus, blow it up. We're more than conquerors. How? Through him who loved us. Jesus. And nothing can separate us from his love. Not anything. Nothing. Because he's the creator. No created thing could ever separate us from his love. So, Wednesday night, the message was, we've come to know and we've believed the love that God has for us. We know God loves us. I know God loves me, but I'm having a hard time believing God loves me. Paul's telling us, listen, you know God loves you. Trust in God's love. You know God loves you. Trust in God's love. And look at that thing that's unfolding and say, you know what? God loves me so much, there's no way this is going to define my life. Even if it's something you perpetrated and fell and it's your own foolishness, the love of God is what defines our life, not any other thing. Nothing can separate us from the love of God, which is in Jesus. So, Lord, thank you for that. Thank you for such a sure and certain victory against foes that are too great for us. Thank you for rescuing us from our own selves, from the law of sin and death that's in our members. We could cry out, oh, wretched man that I am. But Lord, you've delivered us. You've provided the deliverance. We ask you, Lord, and pray and ask in Jesus' name that you would bring the deliverance. We pray, Lord, that we'd walk in the Spirit, be led by the Spirit, have the power of the Spirit, that the Spirit would help us in our weakness. Lord, your intercession for us is always perfect. Conform us to the image of your Son. Work all these things out together for good. Lord, thank you for your love. May we rest in your love. May we know your love. And then we can't help but we pray, Lord, that you'd make us ambassadors of your love. So many don't know, not only do they not believe and trust in the love of God, but they don't even know the love of God. So we ask you, Jesus, to pour out your Spirit on us and make us witnesses of you, so we could share your love with this lost world. And we pray all these things in your name. Amen.